Dear beloved teacher, dear monastic brothers and sisters, dear beloved family, it is indeed a family reunion. It's so wonderful to see all of you. This morning, something very special happened to me. I was walking hand in hand with a young friend whom I had known at least for 13 years. And as we were walking down the mountain, another young woman was walking quite close to me. And I didn't turn to look at her or anything. But then I saw the ants on the ground, so I had to veer a little bit near her even, so she had to step aside. But then she gave out her hand, and she held my hand, my left hand. And I just bent down to look at her face. I knew we knew each other, but in that moment, I couldn't tell who she was. But I knew we knew each other very well. And so we held each other's hand, walking down the mountain. And her name just came up to me, and I couldn't believe. I wasn't sure, but I knew she was. And so when we actually stopped, I looked at her, and I said to her, "Are you Pauline?" And she said, "Yes." And we embraced one another for a very long time. And I said to her, "Do you know, over the years, I have thought of you so often." And I just told you, "Won't you look for me? You know where I am. Just look for me. Find me." As monastic brothers and sisters, we don't have biological children. But we have many children. They are the children that I have taken care of have become teenagers and young adults, which makes me ancient. So I asked her how old she is now, and she said she's 29 years old. And I met her, I think she was only 16 years old. But it gave me a taste what it's like when the ancestors in us, they call for us, "We're here, come back, come back. We're always here for you. Won't you look for me? Won't you find me? Won't you come back to me?" And I experienced that calling in myself as well. My mother, she passed away when I was 12 years old. She was only 36 years old. And we didn't have a very good relationship. My mother was quite harsh. She could be very violent, physically and verbally. So when she disappeared one day, I actually thought to myself, "That's a good thing, because now I don't have to bear her abuse anymore." Being a 12 years old, that was a good thing. And as I grew older, I thought of my mother. And as I became a woman myself, I understood more for her circumstance. And as I became a nun, I yearned for her even more. And then in my early 30s, I started to have a lot of joint pain, physical pain. And it seemed unbearable to me. And I resented it a lot. One day in sitting meditation, it came to me that when we were children, my brother and I, my mother asked us to walk on her back. She had a lot of back pain. So being children, we just wanted to get things over with. So I stepped on her back and, you know, thinking, when could I be done with it? When could I go out to play? But in that moment, as I was in my 30s and experiencing that pain, I thought to myself, I've been away from my mother for 20-something years, but here she is, right in my body. And I experience her physical pain right in my body. And the connection was so intimate, so endearing, that it helped me to bear my pain more gracefully, more willingly. There are those of us here who are fortunate and we know whom our parents are. We know their names, we know their faces. But amongst us, there are also those of us who actually don't even know our parents' names or their faces. We've been adopted, or they've not been in our lives. But if we look deeply, we will see our parents right in every cell of our body. The physical traits that we have, the temperament, the pain and the joy, the way of thinking, perceiving, of behaving, we reflect our parents very much, whether we were fortunate to be near them or not. And of course, that's for the better and the worse, right? What our parents have transmitted to us. So for the theme of this US tour, Healing the Ancestral Hearts, we can ask, where is our ancestral heart? Where can we find it? We have to know where it is in order to heal it. And when we practice, we see very clearly where our ancestral heart is. This very wonderful Dharma instrument that some of you may have seen before. It has an oblong shape like this. And then you see there's a line dividing it into two halves. And half of the beam is black, and the other half is white. Can you see it from here? And on the white side, there is a black dot. And on the black side, there is a white dot. And it's called a yin-yang beam. You can order it online. But you can also call it an intervene, right? It's an intervene because we see that in the white there is the black, and in the black there is the white. My mother, my father, you are in me. And when I look, I see myself in you. This is a very deep teaching of the Buddha, and it's called interbeing. Interbeing. This is in that, and that is in this. This is because that is. I am because my mother is, because my father is. I am not because my mother is not, my father is not. Not only that this is and that, but this is because of that. And when we have this right view, it helps us to have a greater perspective of who we are. We are not individuals. We are not separate selves. But we are just a continuum. We are a continuation of the stream of our ancestors. We can also use this intervene to learn about Buddhist psychology. We also use a circle in Buddhist psychology, and the upper half, we call it mind consciousness. And the lower half, we call store consciousness. The store consciousness will maintain, will preserve, will process all the seeds that they are in us. And when they manifest on the upper level, when it is perceivable by our eyes, our ears, our nose, our tongue, our body, when it is perceivable on the upper level, we call that the level of the mind consciousness. So they exist as seeds down here, and then they manifest. So we can see that true to the spirit of interbeing, in the store consciousness, there is the mind consciousness. And in the mind consciousness, there is the store consciousness. And the flow between them is continuous, is constant. And although the store consciousness is so vast, what is in us, we may not be able to see, we may not be able to be very aware of what's in us. But if we have awareness, if we have mindfulness, we will be able to recognize more and more what's in us, what we have been transmitted, what we have received from our ancestors, because they will manifest in us. So in order for us to awaken to the understanding of ourselves, first of all, we need to be at the same time to be awakened to the awareness, to the understanding of our ancestors. And we see that we are not separate. To find ourselves is to find our ancestors. And to find our ancestors is to find ourselves. And that is why very often when I work with young people, I said to them, you are very lucky you still have your mother and or your father. They're still alive. Get to know them. Ask them about their childhood, about their dreams, about their aspirations, about their struggles, their difficulties. Because when you get to know your parents, you get to know yourself. You get to know why you are the way you are through your own parents. And that saves you a lot of time seeking and fumbling in the dark, not knowing who we are, when who we are is right in front of us, very clearly. From the store consciousness, what will arise, the four elements that I will cover today, we call the four establishments of mindfulness. First one is the body. The body. Then we have the feelings. We have the mind or the mental states, mind states. And then the objects of mind. The Buddha called this the four establishments of mindfulness. These are just skillful means. We can have only one. We can divide into just one category or two or five or whichever numbers they may be. But really, it means that it manifests. From the store consciousness, we manifest in terms of the physical body. The physical formation is our body. And then the mental formations is our mind, body and mind. We make that division. And so getting to know ourselves is getting to know these four categories, these four foundations of our being. And we can see, I will go through them interchangeably, because true to the spirit of interbeing, if you look into the body, you will see the feelings, you will see the mental states. If you look into the mind and its objects, you will see the mental states, you will see the feelings and the body. They reflect one another. They are one another. We just divide them into categories for us to be able to perceive, to understand more easily. So we use mindfulness to observe ourselves and to discover the wealth of our being, the depth of our consciousness. So first of all, something that is most concrete and perceivable is our body, right? So you heard last night about our practice of being aware of the breath of the body. And these four establishments of mindfulness, they also go hand in hand with the 16 exercises of mindful breathing that we will learn over the course of the next few days. But the first four exercises deal with the in-breath, deal with the breathing, the in-breath, the out-breath, and with the body. The breathing belongs to the body, but it also manifests our mind. If you look at the Chinese character for breath, uppercase is the. It means from or itself. And the lowercase means mind or heart. So the breath means the breath is from the mind. The breath also means that it is from, it is the mind itself. Isn't that so telling? So to know the breath is to know your mind. It is like when you are angry, you will breathe differently. When you are sad, you will breathe differently. When I was little, I used to sigh, and my grandmother did not like me to sigh very much. But it's a, because it's a sign that your family will go very poor, will become very poor. So my grandmother said, stop sighing. We get to know ourselves through our breathing. How are you breathing right now? Are you aware how you're breathing? Some people are not able to follow their breathing, to know this is an in-breath or this is an out-breath. Because our mind is elsewhere. Our mind is not in the body. Our mind is not here. So we train the mind to come back to the breath, because that is a bridge between the body and the mind. The breath is that bridge. And as we come back to it more and more often, the mind and the body can be in oneness. But people who have traumas, they're not able to follow their breathing. It's very difficult. Because if you look at the pattern of breathing in a healthy person, you see that the in-breath will take place. It will have this rather steep slope. It comes up. And then there's a little pause here at the end of the in-breath. And then you breathe out. The slope is more gradual. And then you see there's this space right here. When the pressure in the lungs and the pressure outside are the same, there's this state of equilibrium. And you can relax your whole mind and body in this very space. This space sometimes is known as prana. Pra means before, ana means breath. Before the in-breath, before the new in-breath arises. This is the space that we can just release everything. The thoughts, the feelings, the tension in the body. We release all of that. So let us practice together to follow our in-breath all the way through, to notice that short pause before the out-breath takes place, and then to follow the out-breath all the way through, and to really relax and release all the tension, whether it's mental tension or physical tension, we release it all in that space. How many of you were able to follow your breath all the way through, the in-breath and the out-breath? Yeah, many of us. That is a good news. That's a good fortune for us, because there are those of us. Because there are those of us who have gone through trauma in our childhood or in our adulthood, and we are haunted by the experience, then the breathing is not with this pattern. But the in-breath and the out-breath becomes quite rapid and shallow. Very rapid and shallow. So to follow, first of all, to be the aware of the in-breath as it is very difficult. To be aware of the out-breath as it is, it becomes very difficult and tiring. And to be able to follow the in-breath all the way through, and to follow the out-breath all the way through, that's also very tiring. And it can trigger panic in people. They're not able to do that. So we have to see that pattern. Am I in this moment breathing very rapidly and in a very shallow way? To be aware of that, so that we maybe in that moment we're not able to follow our breathing, but we may be able to just follow our heartbeat in that moment, or to just simply raise our hand as we breathe in, to physically do that, or to feel the rising of our abdomen and the falling of our abdomen, so that it's more perceivable for us, more tangible for us. So if you find yourself having difficulty with following your breathing, if it triggers you a sort of panic attack, you know that your body is experiencing this chronic tension and stress, then it's also a sign for us to make time and space to slow down, to take better care of ourselves. The third and the fourth breath deals with the rest of the body. Breathing in, I'm aware that I have a body. Breathing out, I'm aware that I have a body. How many of us are aware that we have a body? Of course we use our body, right? All day long. But actually, most of the time, we're not aware of our body. We can be aware of the screen, the computer screen in front of us. We can be there for hours, but we are not aware how we are sitting, how we are holding our back, our shoulders, how we are holding our neck. And we are not aware of the tension in our hands, in our feet. To be able to be aware of our body and to relax the body, to relax the tension in our body, to relax the body, that is to come back to ourselves, to see the pattern in us. Am I able to relax my body throughout the day? What kind of tension am I holding? What kind of pain am I holding? Where do I carry my sadness? Let us close our eyes and just use one hand to put on the part of our body that we often carry our sadness. Where do we carry our sadness? Many of us, we carry it in our chest, right? Anywhere else that you usually carry your sadness? Do you carry it? Yeah? Maybe in the tension of your jaw? In our shoulders? Yeah. In our shoulders? In our back? In our abdominal organs? We learn to be aware. Breathing in, I'm aware that I'm carrying sadness in my chest. Breathing out, I relax that sadness in my chest. I'm holding it with my awareness, with my tenderness. Breathing in, I'm aware that I'm holding anxiety in my abdomen. It's very tense, very difficult to digest food, very painful. If we When we become more aware of our body, we will see that the feelings manifest in the body through the sensation that we experience in our body, through the visceral feelings, like I feel I'm choking. I feel, we call it the gut feelings. We feel like the sense of doom, or the butterflies in our stomach. The words, the phrases that we use really reflect how we carry the feelings in our body. So to become aware of the body is actually to become aware of the feelings. When we talk about feelings in Buddhist psychology, we talk about pleasant feelings, unpleasant feelings. We talk about mixed feelings. Or neutral feelings. A feeling of joy can be quite pleasant. Where do we experience joy in our body? Yeah, in the chest also. So the chest has a capacity to carry both joy and sadness, doesn't it? Usually. An unpleasant feeling, like anxiety. We need to be aware of it, because sometimes we have anxiety, but because we're not aware of ourselves, we mistake anxiety for hunger. And so what do? We go to food. We eat our anxiety. And if we are not able to feel full because we are so numb to our body, then we continue to eat. And that eating fills up a hole inside of us, a void that is bottomless. And we keep eating and eating and keep hurting ourselves mentally and physically. So to be aware of the body, we will know more about the feelings, and vice versa. So let us listen to one sound of the bell and just experience a part of our body right now, whether it's peace or relaxation or sadness or anxiety. See where we are holding it, if we are able to call it by its true name. Whatever we have, it has come from our ancestors, from this store consciousness. For example, if our ancestors have gone through famine, I remember during the Vietnam War, and my mother's side, we came from the countryside. We were farmers. My grandmother and her ancestors were farmers. And they were very, very poor. So my mother grew up, she would store, she would hoard things. The day that my mother disappeared, there were literally enough soap for us to use for the next 3 years. Yes, boxes and boxes of soap. My mother would have barrels of rice that we ate for at least a year or more. And she also stored lard you know, like the fat from the pork, and she would melt it and would put in these big jars that we use for months and months. So from the experience of her ancestors, of her parents, my mother, and also from her own experience, she learned to store everything. So whatever habit, tendency that we may have, they have come from our ancestors, from their experiences. So I have to watch myself, what I keep, what I store, and to say, hello, Mom, I see you. Do I need to keep 5 jackets? Do I need to hold on to this? And just smile to it, just to say hello to our mother. When we see her appearing in us, the way she speaks, the way she behaves, the way she thinks, we can smile to her. Or we can smile to our father, how he behaves, gently or unkindly, we can smile to them. And the feelings too, the feelings. I remember as a child, I already felt very sad since I was a child. And my brother and I used to tell each other made up stories and we would cry together. We felt sad even before we knew what sadness was about. And as I grew older, I realized that was my mother's sadness. The things that are transmitted to us, they've been transmitted genetically in our genes, but also energetically. I grew up just to see my mother, the way she walked around, the way she talked, her behaviors, her energy affected me. You all know that, right? Your father comes home. You haven't seen his face yet, but the way he opened his door, the way his footsteps sounded, you knew he was angry, and you would rather run into the closet or into the bathroom than facing him. You knew when to approach somebody, and you knew when to avoid that person to protect yourself. So we have received all of that. And we become that. The feelings. We go to the third category of ourselves that we can learn to be aware of. Because to be aware of these mental states, we know where they have come from. The mental states, like joy, that is a mental state. In Buddhist psychology, we have 51 of them. And our teacher has added, I believe, 8 of them. There are many, many different mental states. Feeling is a mental state, but it's separated. It's put into its own category because it's so important. So the state, the mind that is generous versus the mind that is discriminative, that is very confining, that is also a mental state. We learn to call that, to call on it, to recognize as it is, instead of becoming it, becoming consumed by it, becoming identified by it, or to push it away, to reject it and say, no, I'm not this. I cannot be greedy. Greed is not, I don't have greed. I'm not greedy. That is to reject certain parts of ourselves. And to reject them is to actually to reject ourselves. So we learn to recognize whichever mental state that arises in us. We recognize them, we observe them with equanimity. And in that way, we learn to be with ourselves without discrimination. And that practice has to be practiced daily through our breathing. Just simply, this is an in-breath. This is an out-breath. It trains us to recognize the in-breath as the in-breath the out-breath as the out-breath, so that when jealousy, when discrimination arises, you can also say the same thing. Breathing in, I'm aware that this is jealousy. Breathing out, I smile to my jealousy. Breathing in, I'm aware that this is discrimination. Breathing out, I embrace this mind of discrimination. Let us practice that together. Simply recognize whatever that is arising and breathe with it and smile to it. Psychology today talks about trauma in individuals. We know that as PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder. It also talks about collective trauma as a society. As groups of people, we may experience certain trauma, like my sister talked about last night, slavery. That's collective trauma. Psychology today also talks about transgenerational trauma, trauma that is passed on from one generation to the next. And Buddhist psychology has covered all of that through when we look at this model about store consciousness. In the individual, there's the collective. In the collective, there's the individual, and everything will manifest from this store consciousness. Whatever that is so overwhelming, is unspeakable, is unacceptable, is untransformed by us, it will be transmitted to the next generation. Whatever that we cannot transform, we will transmit to our children, to our grandchildren, to the many generations, until they are able to face that trauma, to face that abuse, that pain, that sadness, to transform it, so that it is not again and again passed on to the next generations. So this is something very real. When we had a retreat in Blue Cliff just 2 weeks ago, I met a young girl, only 10 years old, and her father killed himself. She saw her father dead in the living room. And she suffered insomnia. She suffered chest pain. She suffered isolation. She was not able to play with her friends, to look at her mother in the eyes, or to talk to her mother. And I asked her, "Do you think about your father?" And she said, "No, I try to forget him so that I can focus on my study." This is a 10-year-old child. This is her coping mechanism. "I try to forget my father so that I can focus on my study." All of us, we have done that to a certain degree. When we experience something that is overwhelming to us, that is undescribable, unspeakable to us, We try to suppress it. We try to forget it. The mind actually blocks it out of its consciousness, of its awareness. But the truth is that the undercurrent continues to take place. What we are not aware at the mind consciousness, the level of mind consciousness, it continues to play itself, to play it out in the store consciousness, and it will surge in these aspects of the body as chest pain, as indigestion, as headache, as insomnia, as feelings of sadness, of fatigue, in the mental states of not being able to concentrate in her study, not being able to connect with friends. So I told this young girl, please don't try to forget your father. Don't let him die. Actually, keep him alive. Keep him alive. He's in you. Every day you can sit for 5 minutes. When you wake up in the morning, just lie there, massage your face, massage your chest, and say, hello, Daddy. I know you're there. You are in me. I ask her, which parts of you look like your father? She said, my face looks like my father. My hands look just like my father's hands. And my feet, I have the legs of my mother, but the feet of my father. So I said, yes, massage your face and smile to your father. Thank him for the face that he has given you. Hold your own hand and smile to your hands, which are the hands of your father. Walk with his feet and say, Daddy, I walk for you. If you lose somebody and you are drowned in sadness, in sorrow, in forgetfulness, then inevitably you are making sure that that person is as dead as possible. Every time you think about that person, you only think of her death, of his death. Everything you look up, you only think of that person in the tense, in the past tense. But in our practice, we learn to keep our loved ones alive. I learn to say to my mother, Mother, I'm sitting stably and beautifully for you. In the 36 years of your life, you never really had a chance to sit peacefully. You had to hustle and bustle. You had to work so hard to take care of your whole family. Mother, I walk for you. I keep you alive in me. We may try to suppress, to forget, but the truth is that we are affected in every moment. We think this is who I am, this is how I think, this is how I speak, this is how I behave, this is me. But in meditation, We learn to stop, and we learn to look deeply. Meditation is like a bird with two wings. One wing is stopping, and the other wing is deep looking. Stopping means stopping the mind from running, running away and towards, having this attachment to the past, getting hijacked by the past, getting stuck in the past, or getting stuck in the future. We learn to bring the mind back to the present moment, to be in the here and now, where it is real, where we have control over, And true to the teaching of interbeing, in the present moment, there is the past, there is the future. We don't have to run back to the past to find it. We don't have to run towards the future to find it. We only need to dwell stably in the present moment, and we will see. We are because our fathers were because of our mothers were. We are not stable because they were not stable, because they were not even emotionally available when we grew up, because they were not able to handle their own pain and sorrow. And that is why now we are still running, or we are still drowning in those feelings. Let us breathe. When scientists study the brain of people who've been in trauma, this is like my brain looking laterally. This is the frontal part of the brain. This is the back, the occipital lobe. Towards the end over here. So they see that actually the brain, the activity in the brain is changed permanently. The frontal aspect of our brain, that is where it's most developed in human beings. This is where self-awareness is possible. So that unlike our animal ancestors, they are very aware of the objects outside of themselves, like a cat who is aware of the mouse. We also have the capacity to be aware of our own feelings, of our own bodily movements, and not just the objects outside of us. But in people with trauma, this area becomes deactivated. So the awareness of ourselves becomes less. The awareness of the surrounding becomes less. And this is how transgenerational trauma takes place. I've met families where three generations suffer from sexual abuse. The grandmother suffered it when she was young. Her daughter suffered it. And her grandchildren suffered. My own mother was sexually abused, and I became sexually abused as a child. When you are not aware of what is going on inside of you and around you, you are at risk to be abused, to be hurt again, and you are not there to take care of your children. I remember one time I went to the playground with my niece, and we were playing, and she was sitting on this like a ball, and she asked me to spin her real fast, and I spin her so fast she actually flew out of the ball. And she was in such shock that she didn't cry. She just looked at me, and I got so scared, I just prayed. I launched myself onto her, you know, and then she got up, and she looked at me as I was on the ground, and she said, Jojo, she called me Jojo, auntie, you're not supposed to let me fall. 4 years old, she said that to me. And I said to her so sheepishly, but you told me to spin you real fast. I became a kid. You're not supposed to let me fall. We are not supposed to let our children fall, our loved ones fall. But when we don't have the awareness of ourselves, when we cannot take care of our own bodies, our own feelings, our own perceptions and thoughts, our anger, sadness, and confusion, then we will let them down. We will let them fall. And some of us actually even push our children down. We hurt them physically, verbally, sexually. We hurt our children and our grandchildren. And as a nun, I have encountered so many young people who have been abused by their own parents, by their own relatives. And it is very painful. My mother wasn't able to protect me. And so the abuse itself is very painful. But I think more painful than the abuse itself was the feeling of helplessness. The thought that my own mother could not protect me. That's very painful. So we have to be able to see that in us. Have I been able to protect myself, the inner child in me, now that I'm an adult? Am I able to take care of my own inner child, to help her heal, to protect her, and not to let her be hurt again and again and again? The victim has become the perpetrator. The suffering continues because we ignore, because we suppress our pain, because we don't face what we have gone through. And it continues to surge through our thoughts and perceptions, through our speech, through our bodily actions. Now that I have a niece, she's 5 years old, I'm so keenly aware, and my one greatest fear ever is that she has to go through what I had to go through as a child. And I'm determined to help protect her. I told my brother, take care of your child. Be aware of who's with her, whose baby is sitting her. Even if they are her uncles, even if they are her cousins, don't entrust your daughter in them. You have to be there. You have to be aware to protect her. Just 2 days ago, I spent time with my niece. And we were playing dolls. And she said, okay, you play this character, I play this character. And joyfully, I said to her, I was holding this very big horse, and she was holding this tiny horse. And I said, hello, how are you? May I kiss you? And then she said, hello. And she brought the horse close to my horse. And then suddenly I said, no. Don't allow just anybody to kiss you. Only your mother, your father, only when you feel comfortable and safe. And she looked at me, she was startled for a moment. But being a problem solver that she is already, she said, but you can shake my hand. That is so healing. That is so incredibly healing for me to hear that. And I said, okay, let's try that again. And I brought my horse and I said, hello, how are you? May I kiss you? And my niece said, Oh no, but shake my hand instead. And she gave out the one leg of the horse. Healing is possible when we become aware of where we've been, where our ancestors have been, what their pain was about, what our sadness is about. Then we see a way out. So when you have that stopping the mind from running and just being with what is and looking deeply into it, you gain a deep understanding. This is in that. That is in this. This is because that is. And that is not because this is not. That understanding brings about deep love and compassion. It brings about deep healing. And the question about forgiveness is no longer a question. Because when we understand, we don't blame anymore. We don't try to avoid. We don't try to revenge. We understand, therefore we can embrace. And so the next generation can go forward. Every time now when I look at my niece, I think of my mother. Something about her, in her physical features, in her temperament, remind me of my mother, but with a such brighter version, more youthful, happier, with many, many more conditions, advantageous conditions than my mother. And it makes me happy because my mother has a future. She has a better future in me and my brother, and now she has even a brighter future in my niece. Let us breathe together. For the four establishments of mindfulness, which we have gone through, the body, the feelings, and the different mental formations, mental states, we go to the last category, objects of mind. And objects of mind, they are the body, the feelings, and the different mental states. The Buddha also taught us how to look at the objects of mind. Whatever we see, whatever we hear, we smell, we taste, we touch, we perceive in our mind. Observe, first of all, this is exercise number 13. Observe the impermanent nature. Observe impermanence. Observe the impermanent nature of what is arising. When we suffer from trauma, we're stuck in that time and space. We're haunted by it, and it's so alive in us. Sometimes we are so hyper-vigilant, so frightened, and other times we can just collapse and become so dull. We don't feel our own body. We're not aware of our body. We're not aware of our feelings. It's just a state of haziness, of confusion, of chaos in us. But mindfulness is the capacity to be aware of what is going on in our body, in our mind. To be aware of what's going on in the body of the person in front of us, in the feelings in the person in front of us. And when you become aware of that, you naturally see that everything is impermanent. In breath, then it has to end for the next out breath to take place. You have to let it go for the next in breath to take place, and then to let it go for the next out breath to take place. So you see this impermanent nature of the breath. You see the impermanent nature of the body. One moment there's pain, the next moment it's neutral, there's no pain. Sometimes we think we have pain all the time, but if we pay attention, it always fluctuates, right? Sometimes it's more intense, sometimes it's less intense. When we are aware of impermanence, it becomes more manageable. And then we will translate that also. My life, whatever happened, it's also impermanent. That was then, and this is now. In the moment, I am a grown person. I can take care of myself, and I can protect myself, and I can protect my children and grandchildren, my loved ones. So, observation of impermanence helps us to get out of that place that we got so stuck in. The brain, literally, is stuck in certain state. When the frontal lobe, the area of self-awareness, is deactivated, but in the occipital lobe, where images are kept, they become activated so that we may have flashbacks, or whatever we see outside of us will trigger images that we had witnessed or that we had suffered from. So then we are stuck in that state. But to be able to breathing in, I'm aware of a certain image that is arising. Breathing out, I calm that image. I calm that sound. I relax that sensation. If you're able to follow your breathing, if you're able to recognize what's arising, it becomes more manageable. And slowly, slowly, you see that you are able to hold what is, and you don't have to run away from it, to hide from it, or you don't have to get drowned by it. But you can simply watch it, observe it with equanimity, observing the impermanent nature of what is arising. Okay? The second practice for this is to observe the state of non-desire in us. We waver between attachment and aversion. Attachment and aversion. We go from one extreme of attachment, we go to the other extreme of aversion. We are very attached to our past, to the pain, the suffering. And I've shared this in retreats for people in the 12-step program. You think you don't want to suffer. You say you don't want to suffer. Are you sure? Are you sure that you don't want to suffer? And if you're sure that you don't want to suffer, check again. Look at the way you consume with your eyes, the images that you consume. Look at the way you consume with your ears. You consume with your nose, with your mouth, with your touch, with your mind. If the way you consume feeds your suffering, your craving, your confusion, then you are nourishing it. You're helping it to grow day by day. And we are very addicted to our suffering, actually. As you can see in the brain, certain chemicals are released more in people with trauma. Certain neural pathways that we have built over the years, the habits, the automatic reactions that we have, were very much addicted to our suffering, physiologically, biologically, psychologically. Only self-awareness enables us to see these patterns, the way we feed ourselves, we feed our suffering, that we can touch non-desire, non-craving towards suffering, and non-aversion towards suffering. Attachment goes hand in hand with aversion. Desire will go hand in hand with resentment. Pulling will go hand in hand with pushing. So to be able to observe what's arising as an in-breath, as an out-breath, we train ourselves to view everything with equanimity, to know that this is the left foot, this is the right foot. Just the left foot, as we take the left foot. As we take another step, we are aware that this is the right foot. It trains us to have equanimity towards whatever that is arising, so that we can cultivate non-desire, non-craving, and non-attachment, and non-aversion in us. The next exercise, the 15th exercise of mindful breathing, the Buddha taught about observing the no birth and no death nature of all phenomena. No birth and no death. We have been looking at this. We are not fixed, separate entities, but we are a continuum. We are a continuation of our ancestors, of our blood ancestors, of our spiritual ancestors, of our land ancestors, of our animal, of our mineral, of our plant ancestors. They are all inside us. There's no birth and no death, just this continuation. And so it helps to remove the sense of separateness, of alienation, of separation that most of us suffer from, especially in our modern society. When we suffer from isolation, from pain, when we feel that physical and mental pain, it's very easy for us to lash out, to want to punish others, to discriminate. We want to punish them, to exile them. But when we can experience impermanence, non-craving, and non-aversion, when we touch this continuation in us, in all that is, it allows us to be able to be more embracing, to be more tolerant, to be more accepting of what is inside us and what is in others. Which leads to the last exercise, the 16th. So the 15th is the no birth and no death. And the 16th exercise is observe, letting go. Observe letting go, letting go of notions of self versus others, me versus you. Letting go of the separateness that we suffer from, all the mental illnesses that we have, like schizophrenia, schizoid disorder, They're about schism, about the split that we have in our body versus our mind, in ourselves versus others. It brings about mental illness and physical illness when we always see the separation. But when we are able to be more in oneness, to see the body is in the mind is in the body, that my ancestors are in me, and I am in my ancestors. And although I asked my niece, when she was holding her little horse, and it had a bluish, dark blue color that was a bit strange, so I said, "Why does that horse have that color?" And she said to me, "Chocho, it's okay to be different." Where does she get all that wisdom? Must have been from me. The wisdom of non-discrimination. She said, "Chocho, it's okay to be different." We all have that wisdom. So awakening to the understanding means that the understanding, the wisdom about interbeing has always been there. Awakening to the fact that our ancestors are always alive in us. We just become more aware of that. We just come back to that. So it is not something outside of us, something we have to seek, we have to search, but it's actually something that we just need to take time to sit quietly, to walk quietly, to stop running, so that we can see what is as it is, what has always been there. Dear ones, I can't believe it, but we actually went through the four establishments of mindfulness. Let us sit up beautifully. Of course, this is just a brief overview, and within the next few days, my brothers and sisters will expound on it further so that we have a deeper understanding and our practice can also be more concrete and more fruitful. But it's just an overview for us, and thank you so much for being here, although our teacher is not here physically. It's so heartwarming, it's so nourishing for our monastic brothers and sisters to see all of you here continuing to walk with us side by side. And thank you for your love and support over the years.